City was dirty, the park was fans everywhere, nobody walks the city, crime everywhere, corruption here and there. It's like a Gotham City in Batman movie. But in COVID, for example, I learned that I cannot satisfy everybody.
Yes,
any decision
kind of
I make, people will contradict some.
Pak Gubernur, thank you so much for joining this new Pinter Politics show. I want to start with this idea of like, how did you end up going to politics, given your background in architecture, and how does your background in architecture kind of inform the way you think about politics and governance?
Yeah, I was a diaspora like you for 7 years. From 1997 to 2004, yeah. Then in 2004, I returned to Indonesia and work as an architect and also a teaching professor at ITB. 9 years after I returned, I had an opportunity to enter politics in 2013 because in the city of Bandung, the incumbent mayor was already 2 terms, yeah. So in Indonesian politics, maximum service for mayors, governor, or president is maximum 2 terms of 5 years. So 2013, the mayor seat was empty. But I was an independent person, yeah. I tried to convince the people of Bandung that my architectural background would be beneficial to lead the city transformation. I invest first as a social activist, BASF. I founded Bandung Creative City Forum. It's a forum for creative community together to help Bandung. I founded Indonesia Berkebun. It's an urban farming movement. So at least I have some credibility to do something with society as my background. So I entered the competition. I remember during that time, not many candidates using social media. So I maximized the use of social media for my campaign using YouTube, Facebook, and many more. And I won out of 7 other candidates and sworn as a mayor in September 2013. Mm-hmm. So my background as an architect gives me a better perspective because architecture, as you know, the education of architecture is you are educated to be the problem solver. Yeah.
Right.
So many problems, and yet you have to propose the most affordable, the most innovative solution. Mm-hmm. So this kind of training that I had as an architect helped me to transform the city of Bandung. Mm-hmm. Before it was dirty, before it was nobody walks the city, yeah. Because my definition of good city is when people walk, like in San Francisco or many places in Europe. So then I use all my knowledge as an architect to transform, and for the last 5 years the city was transformed by 40 projects. Yeah, so for per year at least I managed to create 8 infrastructure projects. I created also the project called Happiness Project because for me the number one goals as a human is to achieve happiness, pursuing happiness. The evidence of my work in Bandung, for example, when I walk the sidewalk, many people thank me for changing the city of Bandung and saying, "Pak Ridwan, before to get happiness, I have to go to the mall and bring my kids, then I have to pay. But since we have so many new city parks, city garden, now my kids, they don't want to go to mall for happiness. They just want to hop and off to one park to another park. And we can bring food from home, so we save money. So I think this change also create happiness in the form of saving money, in the form of family happiness. Right. And the last 5 years as a mayor, I managed to have more than 300 awards to indicate there is a big change coming from Bandung. Mm-hmm. So after 2000,
but did you ever think about going into politics? Was there kind of this decisive moment for you that you were like, okay, I can't stand this anymore, I have to, you know, do my part as an Indonesian to improve my country?
My dream is already fulfilled as an architect, so becoming a mayor is really what I call a destiny. Is very accidental. Maybe you can call it accidental mayor, yeah, because in 2013, if the city of Bandung was well managed, less corruption, I don't think I would go as a mayor. But that time was so bad, yeah. Yeah. City was dirty, the park was fence everywhere, nobody walks the city, crime everywhere, corruption here and there. It's like a Gotham City in Batman movie. So it was really unplanned process, right. Yeah. Even 1 year before 2013, I didn't have any idea that I would go to enter the mayor competition. Mm-hmm. So I think it was, but I was told, everywhere you go, you have to be the best. So when I was sworn as a mayor, I show the whole energy of my life to be the best mayor, yeah. And that's my value of life, is to be the best, to deliver the best of our ability as a leader. So that's how I politics. And up till today, I'm still independent. So this is in Indonesian democracy, Steph. You have three options to enter the leadership competition, yeah. Mm-hmm. One, you are nominated by party because you are the member of political party. Mm-hmm. Second, like me, you are independent but nominated by party who don't have the candidates, yeah. Mm-hmm. Third, you are independent and nominated by independent voters, yeah. So I'm using the second door. So that's why up to today I'm still independent, not yet any member to any political party, but Indonesia democracy system gives this opportunity of three options for people to enter.
Is that something you want to hold on to? You know, do you think sometimes your life would be easier if you just decided to go with one political party? What's so important about remaining independent for you?
I think it can be changed, yeah, according to situations, of course. Because for me, politics is very noble. It's up to your intention. If you use politics for your wealth intention, then you will do lots of corruptions. If you see politics as a means to transform the quality of life of your civilization, your people, then what you do is engaging and working with ideas and vision to change your society. So my intention coming to politics is merely I want to fix the broken side of my society. I want to pursue happiness for my people and also deliver a new vision to the future of my people and so on and so on. So to achieve that, whether independent or becoming a political party member, it's just a tools, yeah. It's a medium, not a goals. Yeah, the goal is to use politics for better goods, yeah, mm-hmm. for better purpose. So I'm flexible. I'm now proposed by four parties. Yeah. Step. They asked me
so
to be a member to their party, but I still have my mom as my advisor. as a son, I have to listen and obey what my mom perspective. So my mom said, for now, please still do this as an independent individual. So I'm managing the whole process of leadership now still as an independent person.
I think the way you think about happiness and the means to an end is quite philosophical. And I'm kind of reminded by this idea that the best leader should be kind of philosopher kings, this idea of people who don't necessarily want to be in politics become good politicians in a way, because that's kind of the end is for the people. At the same time, sometimes ever since you entered politics, have you had struggles in kind of maintaining the balancing idealism and practicality? How do you try to think about that when there's a lot of bureaucracy and red tape and all of that kind of corruption still around?
The dilemma is everyday business, yeah. Because you have some ideal or noble vision, but sometimes it's not very practical, yeah. So many times I have to break through the bureaucracy, or for example, I created a new system, yeah. For example, I have a problem of fake news, thousands of fake news coming to my society, the hawks, yeah. And the system doesn't have any defense system for this fake news. So as a governor, I created new department. I call it Jabar Saber Hoax, Sapu Bersih Hoax, yeah. So I hire 12 millennials to become the team, to anti-hoax team. And every Monday, they notify the whole people of West Java top 10 hawks of the week, yeah, just to be alert, for example. So this is an example. I have a problem, but existing system doesn't provide the ecosystem to solve the problem. So I created the new working unit. For example, I created Jabar Digital Service, because we are having a vision called Digital West Java, and one problem I solve with one apps, for example. If I have 100 problem, I need 100 apps. So we created a super team of millennial who know coding, and now every time we have problem, we can create an apps to solve the complexity, like a COVID management. We have a Picobar apps. It's very complicated, but it solved the complexity of managing the COVID, for example. So that's one side of how theory and practice is not always the same. But as you know, the quality of leader is seen by the quality of decision. Yeah. If every day I make quality decision, then people will see me as a quality leadership. So to achieve that, I have a group of advisors, Stephanie. I think at the end, I have to make a decision, but before coming to that decision, I have to listen to expert in many form. I have advisor in politics, I have advisor in religious matters, I have advisor in economy, social. So all these advisor inform me in the routine basis to give input. So, but at the end, I don't have to agree to all the decision and to all the inputs. But sometimes I have my own personal perspective. But at the end, this is how I make decision. So if I have a conflict, yeah, between reality and conceptual level, I ask people their opinion, and at the end I execute with my own way. So something like that would be something very routine. But the good thing is we need to communicate with people quite effective. Because sometimes people don't understand the reason behind your decision. So during my leadership, I managed to create 100% of my department now has a social media to communicate the policy. Before I came as a mayor and governor, I think only 30% all department in West Java or Bandung use social media. So social media also is a tool to mitigate the conflicts between the conceptual level and the reality action that we make.
Right, so it's like kind of a combination of you're the type of leader who still wants to hear from people and not surround yourself with yes men. At the same time, you have the responsibility to own those decisions and communicate those decisions. I kind of want to go back a little bit with last time we talked, you were still the mayor of Bandung, and now you're the governor of Jawa Barat. How did that transition, how does that change for you? Kind of, what is kind of the bigger differences? Of course, it's a bigger scale, but did you feel like that was a big gap in terms of like needing to grow into that role, or the way you listen to people have to change, and the kind of people you're leading now is different?
Yeah. Mayor position is very technical. Yeah. You have an idea, you execute. But governor, we have extra role, which is coordinating role. Yeah. Because in Indonesian government management, by law, we have three level of authority. The first authority is mayor level, second authority is governor level, and the third authority is presidential level. For example, in education, yeah, the education for elementary and junior high school is the authority of mayor. Mm-hmm. The authority for senior high school is my authority as a governor, and authority for university is Pak Nadiem, the central government.
Yeah.
So this is how we differentiate the authority. But I'm enjoying the governor more because now I'm exercising my coordinating role. I have to coordinate, for example, COVID, for example, yeah. How to make sure the West Java is in control. West Java is the biggest population, 50 million, but COVID cases, we are number 5. So we are not the biggest ones because we are in control. So managing 27 cities is very challenging. That's the new challenge that I have now. Second, why I like the role of governor, because I can travel to remote areas. Because when I was a mayor, it's very urban, yeah. I don't see rural, I cannot see mountains or beaches. But now, as a governor, I can travel to the remote side of my province. I can go to the high top of mountain as part of my responsibility to the rural area. So it's very diverse experience. So I think that's why the role of governor is more rewarding for me for now, yeah. But philosophically, it's the same. It's basically mayor and governor is the same. You're making decision. You're making decision to the good of your people. But in terms of geographical coverage, in terms of responsibility, governor is more challenging because, as I said, you have an extra role, which is coordinating role. And it's not easy, Steph, because mayors, they come from the different political background. Yeah. Sometimes the governor nominated by party number A, but the mayor that I manage coming from party number B. So sometimes ideological party created a slight different in perspective, but this was is very
what kind of differences in ideologies are we are you, you know, talking about? What kind of issues comes up with the difference of parties?
Just different priorities, yeah. For example, our priorities is for the education, because our ideology saying education first, but there is some leader saying, opa, our priority is not education in my area. My priorities now is infrastructure, for example. So I have to balance our vision of what priorities in the eyes of the governor to balance with the priorities in the eyes of mayors, for example. But at the end, we come to the balance. Yeah. Because we give money also. We give money also to cities and kabupaten or regions also. So I'm using this budget politics to accelerate our vision through the mayor's area or cities.
Do you think is it hard also? Go ahead, if you need to cough. Is it hard also to balance kind of the different needs of people in very different areas? Is that kind of a different challenge as well?
Yes, I think that's the beauty of leadership because every day 90% input to your brain is problems. Yeah, Pak Ridwan, I have problem. Pak Ridwan, saya minta petunjuk. Pak Ridwan, we have situation. Pak Ridwan, we have emergency. 90% coming to my brain is problem statement. Yeah. So as a leader, we are consistently trained to be a better decision makers. Yeah. That's why in order to create a good decision, I need to have a good input or good data. I have a slogan, good data, good decision. Bad data creates bad decision. No data creates no decision. So in order for me to create a good decision, I need a good data. That's why my challenge, and COVID proves, yeah, Indonesia has a problematic issue in collecting one data policy. It's a mess. So it's a challenge for us now to make sure we have a good data. By good data, then we can analyze and create a good decision. So I think that's how I try to.
How are you using the COVID data to inform your decision making?
Sorry?
How are you using the data on COVID that you have or you don't have to kind of inform your decision making process?
Yeah, for example, yeah, like in COVID, how I create a series of decision for COVID. We use the 9 indicators to classify the level of COVID in West Java. The worst one will be red zone, then orange zone, then yellow zone, then the best one will be green zone, for example. Yeah. So how we calculate which one is red, which one is green? Of course, by collecting the data. How many cases, how many people die, how many people recover, the reproductive rate, and so on, creating a data. Once we have a data, we put the input to all area in West Java. Once we have the level of color, then we create a policy. If you are in the red zone, economy can be open only 30%. If you're already in orange zone, you can open to 60%. If you are in the yellow zone, you can open 90% except education. If you are in the green zone, you can open everything but with COVID protocol, using mask, wearing mask, wash your hand, and social distancing. So as you see, when we create a decision of 30%, 60%, 90%, 100%, it's based on data. So this is how I manage. But in COVID, for example, I learned that I cannot satisfy everybody.
Yes,
any decision
kind of
I make, people will contradict. Some support my decision, some bully my decision. It's a daily basis. So I learned as a leader that you cannot make everybody happy. If you want to make everybody happy, just selling ice cream, somebody says to me. But as a leader, I have to create a best decision, whether people like it or not. When we think this is the right decision, then I make the decision to my people. So my philosophical answer would be like this. If the door open in 2024, then I will go.